These videos seem to be very far out from the norm. I mean, if someone says that there's likely to be a crisis in the world and social unrest is likely to take place, and then they say that there is likely to be spiritual retreats, safe places in the world, that those who are looking for stability, genuine stability, will congregate in those places. And then if someone says that there are going to be teachers, very clear teachers in those places to hold satsang and help those who come to those places center themselves and calm down and get a sense of peace and stability. If someone said all those things, would that be way off the mark, way out there? Severe speculation? Or would it be maybe mainstream to some? Because that's a strong part of what is being said here. Unrest is coming to the world. Severe unrest. There are places being set up, set aside for spiritual retreats, for those who want to remember what they are and get away from the instability. These places will accept them, and there will be very clear teachers there to hold satsang. And what one does in these places is simply attend satsang, as we are doing here. That's basically what's being said. So each one has to decide if that's way out speculation or is it something that could very likely happen. Now, it develops further. What if the social unrest of this planet is part of a greater unrest in the solar system and in this galaxy even? And that this greater unrest affects the actual Earth, the planet itself. And that there therefore needs to be retreats, spiritual retreats, for stability, peace of mind, remembrance of what one is, one's true identity, which is spirit. They need to be retreats off-planet retreats, some other places, as this planet goes through a remodeling phase, and that there will be ways to go to those places, those spiritual retreats. So that's another level of talk right there. So I've brought it that far. That's how far I go. I say that is quite possible. That's a scenario that should not be rejected out of hand. But I think for most, there will be places of spiritual retreat. Now, to back this up and bring it out of the realm of mere speculation, let's keep in mind that one of the top-notch guru in the world right now, Sri Muji, a couple years ago, he somehow got some land in Portugal that was offered to him, and he has literally transferred his place of residence to the back country hinterland wilds of Portugal, and is setting up a retreat there, he says, to receive those who want to come and get to be serious about recognizing their true identity. And it is really being set up to be off the grid, meaning self-sustainable, having its own water, its own food, its own electricity through solar power, rechargeable batteries, and probably, you know, satellite connections, uplink connections, and all sorts of stuff that they would literally be able to run fine if all, you know, civilization started collapsing all around. Now, ostensibly, this is being done because, quote unquote, it's very peaceful there. Okay. Well, I'll tell you what, it's very peaceful here in the heart of Silicon Valley where I am. Very peaceful right now. Very peaceful. And all the amenities are here as well. It's very easy to get to. Fly in, fly out, drive in. Very convenient. Whereas in the backwoods of Portugal, very inconvenient, very difficult. I can show you many, many places that are very, very peaceful right here in California. And I'm sure there are innumerable places around the globe that are very peaceful places. So it can't just be, well, we're here because this, we like this. It's a very peaceful place, very nice place. There's more to it than that. The very fact that suddenly there's this, Muji is developing this retreat in the backwoods to receive those who want to come and be serious about truth, about recognizing truth. It certainly backs up what I am saying, that there are places being established around the globe as spiritual retreats to receive those who are truly serious, who truly want to remember what they are, instead of going through the terrible instability that will arise on this planet, which really, what that does is helps one forget what one is, which then enables an ego trip to take place. One can imagine that one is prime creator then, if one has forgotten what one truly is. An ego trip takes place there. So, if we do not want to go on another ego trip, another cycle of existence actually, is ultimately going to come out of this, then we are looking for those spiritual retreats where there are very, very good teachers who can point us in the right direction. Help us calm down. I mean, when the world is in chaos, it's not easy to calm down. We'll need help. So, there's Exhibit A. Muji is Exhibit A. And if he's doing it, you have to believe there's something to it. Because, as I've said, he's really top-notch in many ways. So what I'm saying is that there will be civil unrest brought about by a combination of factors. Certainly the stock market and the financial situation is part of it, and there will be instability, there will be massive modification. In my other videos, I've gone into this very deeply, very clearly, and people will be drawn toward certain areas of the planet and go there. And when they go there, how will their time be structured? Their time will be structured by attending satsang. So these videos here are a precursor to this, preparing those who watch these videos for the discipline of satsang. And realizing it's not that tough. It's not that strange. It's not weird. No, it's just simple communication using very simple language, pointing to some very simple, obvious concepts and ideas, and just listening with open ears. It's not a problem. What is important is that one continue to do this in a protracted manner, like it was a job, like it was going to work in the morning. Because the direction that the planet is going in is one of instability, one of being remodeled, literally remodeled. So one has to really get very clear about what existence is and why this is all taking place, and understand that it's really a dreamlike scenario in order to help us forget what we are, because we want to pretend that we're prime creator. To get very clear about that. Once one is very clear about that, ultimately it becomes possible to relocate to a spiritual sanctuary that is off this planet. But that may be too big of a step, I would say, for almost everyone here. Too big of a step at this time. But as events unfold on this planet, it will become increasingly clear that that's a very, very great option. When one is accomplished in satsang, spending one time listening to the truth, then one will say, well, sure, it's not a problem, not a problem. Let's continue this process of moving towards remembrance of what we are. So, part of what I say is, seems, I'm sure many will believe that, saying that there will be civil unrest on this planet It could take many forms, but generally things are going to get really wild. And that only helps the ego, helps forget what we are, because in reality there's none of that. Everything is very completely peaceful in reality. There's no instability at all. There's no scarcity, there's no lack, there's no trouble, there's no anguish, all the stuff that instability brings. There's none of that. So instability here brings about this forgetfulness. It deepens our forgetfulness of what we are, deepens it. And if we don't want that, we have to sidestep it somehow. So going to these spiritual retreats is the way to sidestep it. So, I mean, if someone is drawn to Muji, they could go to Portugal. And apparently there will be facilities to accommodate those who come there. I guess there's enough land that they could, you know, put up tents, I guess. They're, you know, growing food and provide, and they have water there. And, you know, it's in its developmental stages, but theoretically with enough people pitching in, it could be a very viable retreat. And who knows, there may be plenty of these places around the planet. And so one is drawn to one of these places. There will be a teacher or teachers, maybe a teacher and quote-unquote student teachers, mid-level teachers, high-level teacher and mid-level teachers will conduct satsang. I certainly expect I'll be in one of those places, either on this planet or in other off-planet spiritual retreats, holding satsang as a mid-level teacher. So the plan that I see is that some very high-level teachers will establish these retreats. They'll have mid-level teachers there who are capable of holding satsang and clarifying. And the whole situation will be one of a tremendous integrity and peace and focus and clarity. And it'll be a great time, actually, because one will finally be able to crack that nut of existence and understand why, quote-unquote, bad stuff happens. Bad stuff happens because those who want to continue to pretend to be prime creator, they have to continue to have deep forgetfulness of what they are. And the way to establish this deep forgetfulness, at least temporarily, is to go through tremendous catastrophes. That gives them an enormous jolt of forgetfulness, which then enables them to pretend for another cycle of existence that they are prime creators or could become prime creators. That's how existence works. The purpose of existence is simply to bring about this deep forgetfulness of what we are. Now, I teach along the lines and the general parameters of A Course in Miracles. Okay, I just bought this book a couple days ago after I got rid of my book long ago, maybe in 1994 or something, 96. The first one I bought was in 1978, and I studied it for 15 years straight. And then I stopped and I began to clarify it without reading it. And now just 2 days ago I bought it again and I looked through it and I'm reading it now and it's clear as a bell for me now. Easy. My way of looking, my perspective, is very much in alignment with the way that the author of the Course gives out clarification. I took to it like a duck takes to water. Not that I understand all of it or agree 100% with some of the language, but there's a very strong attunement there. But I use my own words. I don't really spend time quoting it, but it was nice to see an old friend. This volume was just $35. It's a hard hardback. Has everything in it, the lessons for teachers, the workbook, and the text, and some supplemental stuff. And so it may be that I know that the in general the way that the Course in Miracles teaching has gone forward, it's slightly different than my emphasis. I don't resonate so much with the various teachers of the course that are known. I just don't seem to resonate with that. But I do resonate with the language of the course. It's very interesting. It just seems like to me just natural, like a duck to water. And that's a good thing, because whoever authored this course is has a profoundly clear way of using reason. And I would call it a course in reason, actually. How to heal reason. Because truth is completely reasonable. It's not contrary to itself. It's not self-conflicted. It's pure. It's true. It is. And reason can recognize that. Not logic, but reason. Reason is, logic is what the ego uses. Reason is what the Holy Spirit uses. So it was great to see after 15, I guess I've been away from it for quite some time. We'll see. I think around 15 years or more. Let me see. Yeah. Maybe 92, 202, maybe more than that. So it's been 15 plus years that I've not read the Course in Miracles, but I've simply been contemplating truth in my own mind without using any words, written words. And so all of this training was undertaken with the, at least in my perspective, with the purpose of being viable and available during the end times, the difficult times, to be able to hold satsang and in these spiritual retreats. So that's been the aim of my life, to prepare for that, be capable to do it, to be of assistance, be of help, be able to say the right thing, be able to give the right guidance, be able to help people calm down. And I'm not under any illusions that I'm something great at all. I would say that I'm, you know, serviceable maybe, which is a good thing. I feel I'm capable, very capable of doing that. It comes naturally. It seems easy. I'm as familiar because I've spent a lifetime of getting familiar with it. And people will really appreciate whatever help they can get. They may be so agitated that the highest teaching or the highest teacher, it might not resonate for them so well, but they're not sure how to use it. And so mid-level teachers serve a purpose. There's no awe there. You know, awe is not appropriate response to any teacher. High level, mid level. Because really all they've done is they've just remembered what they really are, which is the same thing as what you are, what all of us are, which is spirit, which is that which God extended, Prime Creator extended itself as, and we are that extension. We are one with that extension. That's what we are. We're not human beings, we're not human personalities, we're not anything like that. This whole dream of evolution, of form, of consciousness, etc., is simply a dream of forgetfulness. So, what we're doing here is we're preparing for what is to come, which is what is wise. A warning is only good if it is given out in advance. Of course, giving out any warning advance runs the prospect of seeming to be off kilter, because things change in this planet in such a way that what is going on right now, you know, in several months could be very different. Just the amazing changes that have happened in the last 55 years that I've been here is just night and day. The type of civilization we have now seems to just be so implausible from the past, looking from the past perspective. So, you know, if I were to have told people what the things that I've foreseen, and I did have the gift of being able to foresee things, how things are going to go, people would have said I'm nuts, because, you know, they say this can't possibly happen, no way. And things have happened the way that I've foreseen in many, many, many ways. So, it's not easy to give a warning. Because you might say, you know, for instance, you might say that a huge tsunami is going to sweep, you know, across a country and cause devastation, etc. You know, people are going to say, no way will that happen. You're alarmist, they will say. So if I say, you know, civil unrest, there will be tremendous agitation, turmoil, instability on this planet coming up. The systems that we've been using, systems of civilization, the tools of civilization are changing. The civilization it will collapse. You know, people will say that's far-fetched. It probably won't be that bad, etc., etc. But bad things do happen on this planet. They most definitely do happen. We just would rather be optimistic about it all, which is understandable. But still, the warning must be given out. So those who have ears to hear it, open ears. They check in with their intuition. They get confirmation. And they say, okay, let's get going. Let's prepare in advance so that when situation arises, we'll be able to say, oh, okay, this is what's going on. I prepared, and have a smooth transition. It's better to do it that way. When 9/11 took place, I had foreseen this. I was shown it in a dream. And so when it took place, I just said, oh, that's exactly what I saw taking place. I believed it would happen. I've prepared to keep moving on, and it didn't trip me up at all. I just basically sidestepped the entire uproar and instability around that. You know, wars and all this stuff. I just said, you know, let's just keep right on moving on, because this is just a precursor. This is just a warm-up. This is the warm-up act. So foreseeing things, getting warnings, preparing ahead of time enables one to move much more swiftly. Be prepared. I believe that's the Boy Scouts motto, be prepared. Maybe the Girl Scouts motto too, I don't know, but be prepared. Be prepared. And I believe that preparing for Satsang is the best preparation, because that's what will be available in these spiritual retreats. And I'd like to thank Muji for the great work he's done by preparing many for this, even if they don't go see him. The fact is that he gave out so much satsang on YouTube over the years, has sort of got people used to it and saying, yeah, satsang, okay, I know what it is. Maybe he's made available some live satsangs from Theravada Malai, which I attended on the internet, which was a great experience. I understood, you know, this is how it's done. So he's given some really good advanced warnings and preparation for the world. And like I said, there may be many places around the world with different teachers, different styles. There's not one style that suits everyone, that is for sure. It's obvious that everyone has different preferences, and no one approach will be the end all and be all for everyone. So, Who knows where each of us will go? But the fact is, one thing we'll carry with us is this practicing, the familiarity with satsang. It's the reason why I am wearing this shawl now and getting into more of a satsang mode is because of this. It's very important now to begin to get into that satsang mode and realize this is something that needs to be done. This is something that needs to be familiarized. A comfort zone needs to be established. So one doesn't think they're going somewhere and have no idea what to do. It'd be too much shock. One can be calm, remain calm and say, okay, I'm going to move to this place and I know there I will simply help the whole situation revolve around satsang. Because that's what it will revolve around, clarification. Satsang means clarification of truth. Pointing to truth, clarifying truth. It will revolve around that. And if you have some comfort zone with it, you're way ahead of the game. It'll be very helpful. Very helpful. So I'm shifting into this mode now. In anticipation of what is to come very soon. Events can strike very quickly in this world. We had the oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico. Boom. We had the tsunami in Japan. Boom. Events can really take place quickly, overnight. If we have a conflict in the Middle East, that could happen just boom. Wake up one morning and Pandora's box has been opened. Well, we don't like that. We don't like sudden change. So we kind of just tune it out and say it can't happen. But various precipitating events can happen quickly. And before you know it, change is sweeping the nation, sweeping the world. We've seen that. So many, many phases this world has gone through recently. It's amazing. If I look back, so many phases that now people don't even remember them at all. If I were to bring them up, people would say, what? You know, I've forgotten that, altogether forgotten it. Remember the phase back last century of the alien abduction phase where all these people were coming out of the closet saying they've been abducted. Most of them were female, and they were brought up to spaceships and experimented on, etc., etc. Millions, millions and millions and millions of females said that they had had abduction experiences. And now, then once that phase was passed, I haven't heard of anything like that anymore for a long time. It's like it never happened. But living through that phase, I can tell you it really did happen. It was very much the hot topic. And it just faded away. And there's been many, many things like that. Very intense situations, and then they fade away. And now here we are, where we're holding our collective breath over the turmoil, particularly in Europe. With, you know, dire pronouncements about the stability of the Eurozone and the possibility of severe recession there, and which is a bad thing for the world economy. It's a bad thing. The U.S. economy is stalled. And if Europe stalls out severely and starts to crumble, that will have a tidal wave effect on global financial stability. And if there's too much hedging that has been done, too much funny business that's taken place, too much missing money, something has been squirreled away, that will reveal it, and the fragility of the system will be laid bare. We'll find out if there's been too much funny business going on. And I feel that there has. Many, many feel this way. That underlying the facade, it has been a sort of a looting of money, a diverting of money for various projects that are not well publicized. Some of them I believe has been tunneling under the earth, using these vast tunneling machines to carve out enormous sanctuaries under the earth to ride out the civil unrest that's to come. And a tremendous amount of money has been diverted for that purpose, and that we don't know about, because there are those, we can call them the elites, who have foreseen the chaos that's coming and have planned to go underground. They have, you know, hydroponic greenhouse gardens that grow their food there. They have, somehow they're able to tap the heat of the core of the earth for heat, for energy. They're able to convert energy, so they have, they're self-sustaining under the earth. It's an interesting thing that we have these programs looking for extraterrestrial life, like SETI program. And they're looking for radio signals, and we're looking for life, signs of life on the surface of these planets. And the truth of the matter is that most ET civilizations live under the surface of their planets. It's very uncommon for this type of situation here on this planet. We live on the surface. That's very, very uncommon, very unusual. Living under the earth is more of the norm, because it's seen as much, much safer. Protection from all the catastrophes that hit the surface, like asteroid hits, galactic superwaves, gravity waves, coronal mass ejections, all these things that can fry the surface. Living underground, there's a measure of protection from all that. And so the technology of how to live underground is very sophisticated. Somehow they're able to tap into the heat of the core of their planets and use this as energy to drive all sorts of whatever they need to have a very sophisticated lifestyle under the surface. So, but I am not looking in that direction. I simply prefer to live on the surface. So, spiritual retreats I'm talking about, I would hope that they would be on the surface. But one never knows. One never knows for certain how it will play out. But certainly, there's been a large movement, not, you know, giving any announcements about it, to establish dwelling places under the surface of this planet. And actually, this planet has enormous amount of space under the surface. Huge chambers from ancient times. So there's lots of space under the surface of this planet. That is a fact. And there's been much tunneling under the surface by extraterrestrials in the past. And humans also, a tremendous amount of tunneling. In Tibet, there's a lot of tunneling. There's a lot of tunnels under the surface connecting other places all over. This isn't something that's talked about much. But a lot of money has probably been put into that. So the stability of the financial system is actually, could be very fragile as the stress is put onto it by these crises that are coming up. We find it cannot handle the stress like a sick person who's very sick. When they're asked to do some heavy work, they collapse. They can't do it. So that's what's expected. The health of the world's finances is not what it should be. Under the surface, there's rottenness. Tremendous amount of rottenness. There's been a lot of very clever people hedge things in a lot of different ways, so that now that things are starting to fall apart very unexpectedly. I mean, three weeks ago, Spain declared that they didn't have any problem. I mean, they were going to be able to sail through this thing. Don't worry, everybody. 3 weeks ago. And now the ex-finance minister of Spain or ex-prime minister or something says this is the worst crisis Spain has ever faced. It's an absolute crisis. 3 weeks. 3 weeks ago they were singing a different tune. That tells you right there that there's something not right. There's really something that's not right under the surface. And as the unraveling continues, that could play a very strong role, that suddenly, you know, guess what, folks? we're bankrupt. You know, guess what? We have to freeze assets, that kind of thing. Guess what? It was worse than we thought. So we best be ready. I say in 5 weeks, little 5 weeks from now, probably. I said by June 5th, maybe we'll know more. And so satsang right now, attending satsang online is actually tremendous practice, which is why I'm putting the time in here with these videos, using my time this way, instead of doing other stuff, which I say it's go time right now. It's go time. And that should have a meaning to many. Go time. Meaning it is time to step up to the plate. You know, get off the on-deck circle. Get up to the plate. Face the pitcher. Dig in. Focus in and say, time to get a hit. Time to come through in the clutch. Anybody can sit in the dugout. Anyone can sit on the sidelines. But when it comes time to step up the plate, it's go time. You have to step up to the plate. Dig in. That's what we're doing here. We're digging in. We're getting tough. We're standing up to the situation. We're preparing. We're keeping our nerve. We're saying this is probably the best preparation. Now, let us say nothing happens. Let us say we sail through all of this. Okay, what then? Well, what then would be that we will have done tremendous satsang and got tremendous push towards clarity, and we will simply be able to continue that on. So it's a win-win situation right now, very much so a win-win. Because any time spent in satsang is time very, very well spent. It's the best way to spend time. And let's say everything is fine with the world. Once again, we will then still be very far along towards choosing to remember what we are instead of continuing to be in forgetfulness of what we are. And whatever comes up in the future, we will have detached from that, and we will be moving towards great stability in our own lives and perspectives. So it is a classic win-win situation here. Expect the best, prepare for the worst. And if none of the worst comes to pass, you're still way, way ahead of the situation. But the truth is, from the real standpoint, is that we're already in a crisis. Hasn't become overt as far as financially and social unrest, etc. But we are already in a very bad crisis on this planet. On many, many, many levels, we're in severe crisis mode. I've been in crisis mode since 1997. Full-on emergency crisis mode. Because I was shown the future at that time. I saw what's going to happen. And so far, it's played out just as I was shown. There's enormous crises on the planet. With population, with the ocean, with the atmosphere, with energy. But beyond that, with the world going towards fascination with existence, fascination with, I say, the kingdom of flesh, the world abandoning very severely in free fall, abandonment of the path of remembrance, and instead investing in being fascinated with existence. That is a crisis. That is a terrible crisis. That's the worst. The external physical stuff is unpleasant, but it's not nearly as bad as the inner crisis, where one gets pulled into investing in fascination with existence, with maintaining deep forgetfulness of what one is. Because that really then, that drags one through all the rest of the misery that comes about. And that's already here. That's already happened. That's already a tragedy. It's already happened. It's like the world has been knocked senseless with a devastating attack in subtle ways. Attack on our values. attack on our morals, our ethics, our principles, our focus, our attention, how we spend our time, our expectations. The bar has been lowered so far down that everybody thinks that they're fine because the bar has, you know, been lowered down to the ground. They say, well, I can step over that bar, so I must be okay. People are falling into this deep, 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 deep sleep, even deeper than before, where they're fascinated with trivialities. You can just watch the people. You can just watch them. You see, my gosh, they're so distracted. They're not asking the right questions. They're not focused in the right direction. They are as if helplessly caught up in a current that is rapidly carrying them towards another cycle of existence, towards renewed investment in trying to pretend that they're prime creators, and away from remembrance. And that's already taken place. That's all been very cleverly carried out here. This world has been sabotaged. It's been undermined. It's been termited with devastating effects. And most teaching now is superficial, and the superficial is taken for the profound here, which is, you know, that is severe, because one has to be able to recognize what is profound and what is superficial and know the difference. And when we take the profound to simply be incoherent and take the superficial to be the profound, we have lowered ourselves down into very severe vulnerability to self-deception, to focusing on the superficial, to focusing on the flesh, the body, human beings, human potential, evolution of consciousness, to focusing on the story that the ego is telling us that keeps us in deep forgetfulness of what we are. We're buying into it, severely buying into it, and we become like fall down into even deeper sleep. The world seems to be in a vastly deep sleep now. And there's not a lot of it that is turning towards awakening. The questions are not being asked. So that crisis has already taken place. That's been an ongoing crisis that has, it's been a battle on this planet, because there are entities, very clever entities, who want to turn this planet into a refuge of forgetfulness for them, a resort of forgetfulness. They can come here and experience enormous forgetfulness of what they are, so they can go on an ego trip of pretending that they're prime creators. And they have conformed this planet in that direction, severely attacking and undermining the great traditions of this planet of sobriety, serious inquiry. One's life has to be oriented towards very serious inquiry. Otherwise, it will be turned towards the frivolous. The glitz and the glamour will catch one. There'll be an attraction to it. And that then leads to more pretense that one is prime creator, can be prime creator. The idea that we can become prime creators, which is the height of delusion. Or, you know, the depths of delusion is a better way to put it. So that crisis has already been upon us for a long time now. And it's gotten... And if we've survived this far, and if we're capable of listening to Satsang this far, we've done a tremendous job. Really. Anyone who's listening to this with open ears and hearing it and picking up a lot from it has done a tremendous job. Outstanding job. Unqualified success. Just to be able to do this, that means somehow one has had enough Teflon, you know, to let this, all this water go off their backs and work through it and not get stuck in it. Which has been very difficult. The last 50 years or 55 years on this planet have been enormously difficult. And it has snared almost everyone. The tentacles of attraction have been out there trying to grab everyone, pull them in to the maw of self-deceit. And forgetfulness of what we are. And thank God there have been some great teachers who came in the 20th century who gave us so much clarity that if we caught wind of that, we had tools to get through to this time. They were like a bridge to this time. And I'm talking about the 20th century. There were some outstanding teachers here on this planet. Absolutely top tier. There's some that are well known, some that are not so well known. But I believe that most of the great traditions had some outstanding teachers here, really. And there were some mavericks as well. And those great teachers of the 20th century gave us this boost, and I was able to catch wind of those teachers. I was aware of them from birth. I was aware of them. And was able to focus in and get help from them, which helped me get through these times so that I'm available now. But it was extremely difficult, and I got caught up in all sorts of snares. It was a very tricky time. But it was successfully bridged, so now we're now at the point where the bridge has been crossed and we're ready to actually go into those spiritual sanctuaries, retreat to those spiritual sanctuaries, which are overseen by these great teachers. And those great teachers will have their mid-level teachers helping them out there. So, the fruit of those great 20th century teachers will become known to us ever more so during these times of unrest, as we find out there are spiritual retreats and there are really very effective, helpful teachers there holding satsang, and they will point out that their teachers, you know, were such and such, in my case, Ananda Maima, Ramana Maharshi, and then of course Jesus Christ through A Course in Miracles, and the Bible, and his incarnation a couple thousand years ago. All of that was very helpful, along with some other traditions. I can name Jiddu Krishnamurti, Mary Baker Eddy of Christian Science, which helped New Thought, the whole New Thought process, which eventually was able to give birth to A Course in Miracles and help it along. Sri Nisargadatta, which is a great non-dual teacher. Punjaji, another great non-dual realizer, self-realizer. Those, and there are others, many others, in various traditions. You know, there's some, I'm sure, in the various Buddhist traditions. And I'm not, you know, familiar with the entire scope of it. But there have been some great teachers, and those teachers have their students, have their devotees, who are capable of helping out. So the situation has been bridged. It's been bridged. Which is a great thing for those of you who have struggled through, just to hear this, to hear the fact it has been bridged. Is the gospel, is the good news. It's been bridged. I can tell you, I'm declaring that right now. The entire situation of the subversion of this planet, the attempt to enslave everyone here, the attempt to enmesh everybody into another cycle of existence, to participate in a mass planetary sacrifice, to provide this huge ego kick, huge ego trip of severe sacrifice, which leads to then severe forgetfulness of what one is, which leads to, opens up the door to tremendous pretension of being prime creator. All of that has been bridged. It didn't work to wipe out any bridges. The bridges are there. They're all over. Muji is a bridge. He used the Ramana Maharshi Punjaji bridge as part of his bridge. He also received some help through the Christian tradition, through the Jesus bridge, and maybe some others too. So there's an example of a bridge, and there are many bridges around the world right now who've been able to bridge these most difficult, trying times. Enormous subversion of this planet by very clever egotists on a very strong ego trip of believing that they can be prime creators. And they're very good and very clever at what they do. Very arrogant, very feeling very entitled to do whatever they want to do to continue this ego trip because they believe that they are prime creators. They believe they're the rulers. They're the authorities. And the problem is that this ego trip keeps wearing thin. And they have to get some more forgetfulness of what they really are, because the remembrance of what we are keeps seeping in through the cracks, always. Can't keep it out. Only temporary can you keep it out. Can you lessen it? It's always there. And as soon as we let up a little bit, as soon as we get bored with our ego trip, as soon as we start doubting, we start remembering. So those who are on a very severe ego trip, thinking that they're the rulers of reality and they're the prime creators, they start feeling like, hey, maybe we're not. We feel like we're slipping, starting to fall down away from this sense of supreme entitlement, and they desperately search for another ego, another jolt, another hit of severe forgetfulness. And they came to this planet as foreseen and have configured it in a way so that it will give them this massive hit. And it's done through tremendous sacrifice, mayhem, death, sacrifice, despair, fear, hatred, all these intense emotions and experiences that give them this enormous hit of forgetfulness of what they really are. And that enables them to again indulge in fantasies that they're prime creators, indulge in these fantasies. That's the ego trip. And they've been able to, they're very, very good at what they do, very skilled at what they do. They've been doing it for a long time. And they're able to accomplish that here. They're able to find ways to subvert the planet and lower the planet's resistance, lower the planet's will, and get everybody, pretty much everyone, to go along with it, thinking it's to their benefit, and tried to break the will, tried to break, stop the bridges from being built, but they failed at that. They failed, as one would predict that they would fail at that, because these great teachers didn't come into this world in vain. Ananda Mayama didn't just show up here in vain for no reason. Yes, she was called into the world by the desire to have help here, but being here certainly enabled bridges to be built, had a tremendous effect. Same with Ramana Maharshi, tremendous effect, enabled these bridges to be built. There's really been a massive war on this planet, spiritual war, so to speak, as these entities on this it's severe ego trip subverted the planet and turned it towards sacrifice and destruction and catastrophe and many, many, many very wicked ways of forgetfulness. There's also been a tremendous effort to build bridges across these canyons, these abysses, to build bridges across, and so we can get to these spiritual retreats and we can get to satsang. And we can just say, yeah, this is all familiar to me. This is all very normal to me. Because there's been this bridge through the last 55 years. Maybe the last, 100 years. There's been a bridge. There have been bridges built. We've been traveling across these bridges. And now we arrive at the other side of these bridges. And we say, yeah, all right, yeah, spiritual retreats, great teachers, great satsang. Sounds great. Sounds just what we needed. Right situation, right time. Done deal. And we will give ourselves a great round of applause, a great pat on the back, and great respect for doing this, because it's been extraordinarily difficult. Many have fallen by the wayside. And without the grace of God, without the grace of these great gurus and teachers and traditions, we would all have fallen by the wayside. Almost without exception, I certainly would have fallen by the wayside, no question about it. I came across the Course in Miracles, 1978. I established a very strong connection with Ananda Mahima in 1997. I've been aware of Ramana Maharshi for most of my life, Ajita Krishnamurti most of my life, and other situations. And all of that added up to when I came across Ananda Mahima, I just said, "Oh, wow, holy cow! You know, this is really top notch, absolutely top notch, and this is going to have a positive effect on my life because I see what is possible. I can see the satsang. I can see, you know, this can happen here. This really can happen here." This one is very competent. You know, this one knows its business here of building these bridges. Like, I just saw it right away, immediately. The second I saw it, immediately I said, "Wow, this one it knows their business." And you know, they're going to take care of business, no question about it. And then I got heartened. I said, "You know what? We can bridge this time. We can reach a time when we will be able to." Receive a massive boost, a big boost, and turn towards remembrance of what we are, and turn away from forgetfulness of what we are. And I had the good fortune, I guess you could say, of being born with precognition, being able to see the future, so I knew what was going to take place, and so I was very serious from the get-go. If you look at pictures of me when I'm young, I'm always terribly serious. No frivolity there at all, just, you know, tremendous focus, because I knew that there would be, the subversion of this world would take place. I knew that there'd be a vast falling away into fascination with existence, and I knew that there would be so many snares laid out for everyone, and that the chaos was coming, that there was terrible problems with finance, economics, and eventually with the structure of the planet itself. Yes, I knew all of this from birth, which means I was immediately seeking for help from the get-go, from day one. And in seeking for the help, I found the help. And finding the help, it was possible to build the bridge to these times now, through the difficulty, get past the difficulty, and now be viable to help out with satsang. That's how it worked. If not for these great teachers, yeah, no way. Great teachers and great teaching. Course in Miracles is a great teaching, I can tell you that right now. Like I said, it's a course in reason. It's a course in reasoning. It's not really a religious course at all. Some people think that it's some kind of New Age thing or something. No, it's not. It has nothing to do with that. It has everything to do with reason. Clarifying reason. Being able to reason clearly. To pull out of insanity. To recognize that we've been using the logic of plausibility, which is frivolous. The ego uses the logic of plausibility, which reason shows to be a fraud. Reason will point out, say, "Hey, wait a minute, you're just completely neglecting this. You have to factor that in." Plausibility just dismisses it. Plausibility always is hiding something. It's a fraud, a sham. And the Course in Miracles points that out, helps us see through it. So tremendous work. It's my favorite course. It's my favorite teaching in book form, for sure. As far as teachers, my favorite teacher is Ananda Mahima. As far as her taking care of business, nobody did it better. Unbelievable. Constantly on the move, constantly setting up satsangs everywhere. It's just amazing. And then as far as abiding in peace, my favorite is Ramana Maharshi, who, it's just unbelievable, the bliss, the look that he had, the tremendous peace that is streaming off of him, just the presence, it's just fabulous, incredible. As far as presentation goes, my favorite is Muji. He has tremendous presentation with his satsang. just a extremely gifted wordsmith and able to put people at ease. Extremely gifted in that way. And everyone has their favorites. These are all bridges. These are all bridges. I love the dignity and the poise of Krishnamurti and how he held a satsang. Wonderful satsangs in California, here in Ojai, around the world, outdoors. Many people would go to those. My grandmother went to satsang with Krishnamurti back in St. Louis. I've met people that attended Anandamayi's satsangs, and they say absolutely unforgettable. They've never forgotten it. Simply incredible, amazing. These are heavyweights, you know. And I certainly hope and pray we have a chance to have satsang with these heavyweights again, because even though they've dropped their body, that's like nothing for them. It's like they just took off a suit of clothes. They can easily be present for us. Easily. They can put on an appearance for us. They don't even have to be born. They don't have to take birth to actually show up. Just project a body. For them, it's a piece of cake. Effortless, if they want to do that. So I've always said, you know, we'll see these gurus again. We'll see them again, for sure. I mean, Jesus pointed that out very clearly, you know. He resurrected his body. And he said, I will return. You'll see me again. And I believe that. I absolutely believe it. It's very true. These gurus may very well return to this earth and be present in these spiritual retreats, these great teachers. I believe it, that they will. Maybe not at all times. Maybe they will appear sometimes and not be there at other times. I don't know. But they will be present. They are dedicated to helping us out. They know the troubles on this planet very well. They know it's been subverted. They know that these extreme egotists have turned this planet and what their intentions are to use this planet for their own ego trip. And they know that many people agree with this. And they know the difficulty that those of us who disagree with this, who don't want this for ourselves, who want remembrance of what we really are, they know that we need help. And they will help out. They have been helping out. They've helped build the bridge. They started the bridge. We worked on bridging it, and now at the end of the bridge, we'll probably see them again. And they will set up very good satsangs, very effective satsangs. We have that to look forward to. We really have tremendous satsangs to look forward to on a level higher than we've seen, higher than we know. Beautiful. Really profound. This is just, you know, what we've had is warm-up acts. And this here, you know, I remember attending a concert once, one of the few that I ever attended. I wasn't a concert goer, really, because I didn't like the atmosphere, really. There were four acts. The first one came on, they're really good. Second one came on, they were better. Third one came on and they were fabulous. And then the final headliner came on and they just blew my mind. They were just absolutely incredible. So you get these warm-up acts here. This channel on YouTube is just a warm-up act. It's like the first act. Just getting you warmed up and, you know, getting your seat. You know how a concert is, you're doing stuff, talking to people, and you finally get to your seat and first act is playing and you start listening, you start getting the music, tapping your feet, getting into it, feeling it a little bit. And then, you know, the second act comes on and you're into it more, and by the time the final headliner comes on, you are really into it. It's like that. So this is just a warm-up act here. But a warm-up act is also part of the bridge, right? So bridging the situation is extremely important, very important. All important. You cannot come up short now. We have a few more steps to go. Give it 5 more weeks. Give the world 5 more weeks. Give it 5 weeks of satsang. And then we'll, you know, check in and see where we're at. Yeah, right now it's even getting closer to 4 more weeks. Just give it that. Just hang in there. Hang in there till July 5th. Just hang in there. Pay attention. You can do it. You've come this far. You can go a little further. And let this idea percolate, resonate, that there will be better satsangs to come. Way better. You know, with the full thing. Full experience. Full profundity. And we'll build up to it. We'll build up to it. We'll get better and better and better and better and better. I used to even stage a dry run satsangs. I even have some video of that. Maybe I will post that for you. Back when I was working with Ananda Maima, setting up these mock satsangs. Beautiful, beautiful pavilions, flowers. The atmosphere was incredible. I set all this up and nobody came. But I was doing this to get familiar with what was possible. And really, I had things set up that were so beautiful. And shrines and tapestries and everything that were just gorgeous. I'll dig into those videos if any of you want to see it. I have some videos that I took. I was taping back then with magnetic tape, with digital tape. And by doing that, I saw that it's possible to set things up in very, very beautiful ways and to create a very, very holy, serene, beautiful atmosphere. And then for the satsang to take place in those conditions can be something that reaches very deep within us and evokes recollections and memories of what we are and brings us in that direction profoundly. It's a funny thing that I'm getting light on this video because it's pitch dark outside. And I just realized the fact is that the screen of the laptop is bright. It's an LED screen and it's literally providing all the light that you see right here is being produced by this screen of my laptop. That's pretty funny. That's great. Very interesting. So I guess I could stay out here all night just doing this. And we'll be working out great. This video is done in old style, okay, in tribute to the teachers of the 20th century and the video that is available of them, video of Ramana, video of Krishnamurti, video of Pundaji, video of Anandamayi Ma, a lot of it's black and white. I think Pundaji had more color video, but a lot of the, their Mayor Baba, you know, there were quite a few gurus. Neem Karoli, Baba, you know, there are many. Babaji, etc., etc. There were some great Tibetan Rinpoches, etc., you know. Most of the video is black and white. It's old, it's grainy, it's got artifacts in it. So we're doing this video with like that old style in tribute to these wonderful, irreplaceable, great teachers of the 20th century who were the ones who really built the foundation for the bridge that we have been able to construct that have got us through to these times, 2012. Remarkable accomplishment, really. And honestly, there were many times I didn't believe I would make it. Many times. It's an incredible thing for me that I'm actually here in 2012. So much opposition and difficulties to get to this point. I mean, the egotists who have subverted this planet did their utmost to subvert me. They really did. And they're not happy that they failed at it, that's for sure. They tried to subvert everybody, you know. They tried to get rid of any opposition to their plans. I don't oppose their plans. I simply insist on our plans to sidestep it. That's different. Sidestepping is not opposition. They're free to do what they want to do. We're free to do what we want to do. It's all free will, free choice. They can choose delusion. We can choose reality. They can choose insanity. We can choose sanity. That's how it works. That's what I tell them, you know. Hey, that's how it works. That's what's fair. You know, they don't accept it. But, you know, someday they will. And, you know, whenever they want to. It's up to them. There's no ill will. There's no hatred. There's no mean-spiritedness towards anyone here. You don't get that in Satsang. You don't feel that. There's admonishment. Hate the sin, love the sinner. I mean, there's admonishment, but we don't pay much attention. I mean, what's done is done. If they want to go to another cycle of existence, you know, that's what they're going to do. I've already seen it. I know that's what they're going to do. So what? That's their choice. They want to ego trip a little longer. But, you know, it'll always be tough for them. Always. And eventually some will start falling away and saying, forget it. What can I do? And then, you know, eventually they'll make their way to Satsang, self-inquiry. Whether it be with a teacher or with a curriculum, a course, like A Course in Miracles. A Course in Miracles was a lifesaver for me. Absolute lifesaver. Without it, I would not have succeeded. No question. Lifesaver. Because I came into the world knowing that the course was going to be written. I was aware of it ahead of time. And I actually told people. I said, look, those people who are in despondent, I said, look, there's going to be better teaching coming into the world. There's going to be a very advanced course of teaching coming into the world soon. And if you just wait for that, you'll find that you'll get tremendous help from that. And then in 1978, when I came across the course, the book, I very quickly realized this is it. This is what I knew was being worked on. I was aware of it. And then when I got it, you know, I said, oh boy, this is just what I needed. Because we were getting entrapped in a very clever manipulation of psychology. And we were getting pulled into superficial explanations and believing that our identity rested upon those superficial explanations. What the Course in Miracles did was it didn't attack that. It did not attack psychology. It simply worked within that context to gradually expand the context and eventually leave it behind altogether and deepen it back to where it belongs. So it was absolutely the most incredibly magnificent bridge. Because in those times, I don't know if anyone can remember those times, I sure do. The gurus of those times were the psychoanalysts. And we felt that, you know, that this was it. This is how we are going to find out what our identity is, through psychoanalysis. And, you know, the Jungs and the Freuds and the Adlers and the Karen Arnies and the Reichs and the so many Alexander Lowens and so many, you know, all these superstar psychoanalysts. I'm leaving many off the list. Might I say Adler and so many of them, you know. I knew them all. I was aware of all of this. Read them all. Studied them all. And those were our touchstones of the Western, you know, modern scientific age. That those were the people who were supposed to be able to lead us to the promised land. And they were woefully inadequate to do so. It was a joke, really. But the times were such that really we were entrapped in that, severely entrapped in it. I kid you not. They were the authorities of the times. And this had permeated all the educational institutions. All the advanced institutions were grounded in this, were set in this, most of them. Status required that one take this as the basic context of progress. there was not really any viable alternatives. Of course, I was trying to bring in alternatives. I tried to bring in Ramana Maharshi. I tried to bring in Krishnamurti. I tried to bring in Christian Science. I tried to bring all those things in and said, hey, people, you know, this is better. But really, it was such a heavy trip then that you had to accept the context to have any voice at all. Context of these psychoanalysts and the whole theory, psychological theory that had developed mostly from Germany. Very bad theory, actually. But the course didn't attack it. The course almost accepted it, you know. At first, it started out by saying, yeah, these guys are great, you know. Therapy is where it's at. Psychotherapy is where it's at. You just need to improve it, you know. And so a lot of people who took the course first were psychotherapists. Still are. I never was. And I simply moved past all that and got into the course, you know, very quickly, very deeply, and saw that it, you know, eventually it expanded the context to leave all that way behind. And by doing that, it provided a bridge for me to get past that completely. At one time, I was completely stuck and saw no way past this. The authority of all the psychoanalysts, they just ruled, you know. And psychiatry came out of that, and they literally, every question was referred to them. All the questions of life, of living, we all provided a psychoanalytical answer. We psychoanalyzed everything. Everybody did, all my friends, all my contacts, the adults. It's all we heard about. And I was, you know, a maverick saying, hey, what about these Eastern teachers, you know? What about, you know, at that time, Jesus was getting, you know, put in the context of he was a great psychoanalyst. You know, that's how he was seen. And I said, no, he's way, way beyond that. But I you know, tried to bring in these other traditions that, you know, there was, and the winds from the East, from Ramana and Anandamaya Ma and others there, were reaching these shores bit by bit, very faint, you know, but we got caught wind of saying, hey, I remember Maharishi Mahesh Yogi that the Beatles made popular. He brought some of that flavor, some of that wind over, kind of caught people's attention. Transcendental meditation. There were others. I mean, Yogananda was a very big one, very key, played a huge, huge role. Actually, I read Autobiography of a Yogi at a very early age, early 60s, I think I read that when I was young. Maybe when I was 8 years old, 8 or 9 years old, I could read at an early age. I read that, and really that just said, wow, you know, hey, folks, there's some option to this dominance authority of psychoanalysis. But it was not easy to get through that. But A Course in Miracles really knocked it out of the park. It aligned itself with the whole psychoanalytic movement, but it also helped bridge us past it. And a lot of the teachers are again, therapists, which is why I don't resonate with it so much, because I don't see myself as a therapist at all. I see myself as a holding satsang, clarifier of the big picture clarifier, which is what I feel is really pointing to the true therapy, which is to choose a new idea. Choose the idea of not trying to be a prime creator, which is truly to repent, which is what Jesus told all of us, who was certainly perhaps the greatest, you know, teacher of all, and the originator of a great tradition, said repentance. Repent means choose a new idea. That's what it actually means. Change, switch belief systems of your mind. That's what repent means. And that's the actual remedy. And that's what satsang points to. You must choose a new idea to be healed. You must. Everything else is a precursor to that. Being kind, being loving, all of those things are a precursor to it. But eventually, as Jesus says, and as Anandamaya Ma says, you must have the vision of oneness. You must have that vision of oneness. Otherwise, you cannot know God. You cannot, because reality is one. It's not stitched together. It's not stitched together parts. It's not tailored. God is not a tailor. The prime creator It's not a seamstress. It's one seamless whole with no parts to it. Everything is one. So if you want to reject part of it, you have to reject all of it, because there is no part of it. If we want to forget what we are, we have to forget the entirety of reality, the totality of it. We must have a scenario that induces forgetfulness of the totality of reality, the oneness of it. We must forget all that. We must see fragmentation, massive fragmentation everywhere, massive change, massive modification. We must see that. We must perceive that. Perception itself induces extreme forgetfulness of what we are, because reality is not perceived. Reality is not perceived, it's experienced directly. It's lived directly. It's not perceived. And so we must choose a new idea. We must experience the effect of that idea. We must abide in the perfect peace of that idea, the non-modification that's there, the presence, still presence, no modification. Ultimately, we must do that. But first we have to get there. We have to actually choose this. No one can choose it for us. No one can impose it. If it could be imposed, then certainly Jesus or Nandamayama Ramana would have imposed it on us. They could not. I know there are traditions where supposedly the guru can boom, you know, give you this bliss, but you cannot impose abiding in the stillness, the still presence of the non-modification. That it has to come as your own choice, because you, that is how you function, is through choosing ideas. Nobody can impose this upon you. The bliss that the Shaktipat, you know, boom, here's the bliss. That's temporary. It's some kind of alteration, you know, some kind of alteration of consciousness. All that's possible, but it's not the same as choosing a new idea and doing what Ramana did, abide in that perfect bliss, perfect peace, perfect oneness, perfect non-modification, perfect stillness, perfect emptiness, perfect spaciousness, pure awareness, pure consciousness. Simply abide in that, as Anandamayama did her entire life, just immersed in that continuously, effortlessly immersed in that. That can only come through clarity and then choice. One has to be very clear enough to choose it. Cannot be imposed. So don't worry. Nothing will impose it upon you. Come to see the greatest teacher ever. They can't impose upon you. They can suggest it. They can attract you to it. But it's your choice, always. This can never, your choice can never be forfeited. You can't go into some trance and put yourself under the will of someone else and have them imposed upon you. It cannot happen that way. It's impossible. There are many teachers on the planet right now who are teaching siddhas or our spiritual powers, thinking that that is sufficient to get through the times of the future. It is not. It's not sufficient. It's not sufficient. Psychic powers, all these powers are not sufficient. Sidestepping. Maintain the focus on satsang, attending satsang. That will keep you in the spiritual sanctuaries. That will keep you safe. That will get you through whatever happens on this planet. Ultimately, you'll be able to sidestep it to other places. Just stay in the satsang, because there's satsang in other places that are on this planet. There are spiritual retreats. I've been shown some of those retreats, and they're there. If you stay within satsang, you will deepen your capacity, become greater and greater, and you'll have access to those spiritual retreats. If you just develop spiritual powers, you will try to use those powers to battle with the egotists who are in control of this planet. And you will find yourself involved in tremendous conflict and difficulty, because you should not underestimate the capacity of these egotists, because they are very capable of what we call black magic or magic. They're very clever and very tricky at it. It has to do with manipulating belief, manipulating plausibility, using fear and lies, deception, cleverness, all sorts of leverage. They're very, very adept at that. You don't want to mess with them. do not give the devil its due. Realize that these egotists have an enormous sense of entitlement. And they feel that they are entitled to do whatever it takes to keep their ego kick going. So instead, step into satsang. Step into that. Align with satsang. Continue it. Align with self-inquiry. Get into it. It's your ticket. Literally, this is your ticket. And this is just one little stream here, a little tributary, leading to larger streams. That's how it works. All around the world now, there's people, teachers giving satsang. Many online, and many in little gatherings all throughout the world. Those are little streams, little tributaries. Those streams lead to little rivers. And those little rivers lead to greater rivers. And those greater rivers lead to even mighty rivers. So get in that stream. This is one little stream here. I believe it's effective. I believe it's helpful. I believe it's a good one. That it's very valuable. And that one can use this little stream here, very humble little stream, to move into a larger stream and into a small river and then into a greater river. Like that. Very doable. In fact, it will happen. It will happen. I hope someday I'm able to attend a satsang from really a great teacher. I've never had that privilege. You know, I have seen several teachers, but I wouldn't call them great teachers. I've been several luminaries. Some of them, you know, were, but they're not top notch, not top notch. It's tough. It's tough right now to find. Hopefully I know we will find top-notch teachers in the retreats. And as for now, until that time, we put our attention on the little tributaries, the little streams, little creeks, the little streams. And we get used to it. We dip our feet in the water. We're wading right now. We're wading in satsang. But as I said before, it can become more and more profound, more and more wonderful. Let's see what I can do, if I can stitch a video together that gives you some of the sense of some of the things that I've done. I had a really amazing situation set up. Incredible tributes to the teachers of the 20th century. And spent enormous effort on that. So I know it can be done. Definitely profound satsangs and spiritual retreats can be set up. And I believe Muji is setting one up right now in Portugal. But there need to be a lot of them set up. And we will find out very soon about these. I really believe that we will start finding out that, hey, here's a wonderful situation that's been all organized and set up ahead of time for us. It's not a joke. Like again, I said, it's not a joke. Muji is actually doing it publicly. It's actually happening. That's one example. Other examples are happening, probably they're not known yet. They're not well known. Because the egotists will make their move soon. They will make their move to crush this planet, the will of this planet to resist them. They will make their move to crush it. They will make their move to push this planet into panic. Into panic and mayhem. And you've seen some of the weaker ones of us acting out in bizarre ways recently. It's been in the news that, you know, people are losing their minds. They're flipping out. The whole planet is going to flip out. You know, the egotists will make their move. And they're very decisive. When they make it, they're going to make it strong. At that time, it's time to flee into the spiritual retreats. And that time is coming soon. So we are preparing. Taking it seriously. Other people, of course, will say, you know, there's nothing to worry about. There's everything to worry about. These egotists are here. They've infiltrated the planet. They're very much in control of the planet. And they are ruthless. I know, because I've had dealings with them. They've tried to, you know, subvert me, seduce me, bring me help, get me to help them, etc. I rebuff them, and they don't like that one bit. They have an entitlement complex, and it's very attractive to many on this planet. Many on this planet have fallen under their spell, and many movements on this planet have actually been helping them out, because the entitlement complex they have is very seductive. Very seductive. There have even been some gurus in this world who were working for them, who were spiritual egotists, really. And the people fell under their spell because their entitlement complex. They said, hey, I'm the prime creator. I'm the greatest. You know, here I am. And people just say, oh my gosh, we can have this too. You know, this entitlement feels wonderful. This ego, spiritual ego trip feels like, well, we can do it. We can be, you know, the prime creator right now. And so many were seduced into this, and they have this now sense of entitlement that they too can impose their will upon everyone, and they can have their agendas opposed on everyone, that can shove down everyone's throat, whether they like it or not. Because once you go into this egotistical entitlement complex, you don't care what other people think. You feel you're in the right to break their will. That's what happens. So these extreme egotists seduced many in this world, and then have them doing their will, their bidding on this planet to shape things the way they want them to have shaped. I'm not sure how long this has gone on, because I can't really see what it says there, but I know it's been a while, which is a good thing. And we're covering many areas, which is what happens in Satsang, you know. Many areas will be covered. You know, I'm capable of, you know, rattling off, you know, non-stop areas of talk. Whatever. Can go many, many, many places and get all these little nuggets, you know. Collect a bag of nuggets like we're prospectors. It's not a problem. And homage to all those great teachers that came. A lot of them top-notch. Some of them extremely top-notch. Some of them a little less. Some of them very good. You know. And then a few, recently we've had a few spiritual egotists along the way who had this entitlement complex. And actually getting past them was very difficult, really. Because they had such strong authority and entitlement complex. They said, I am it. I'm the one. Here I am. Bow to my authority. It wasn't easy. Obviously, I could see they're not it. How? Because I had the touchstones. I had the touchstones of A Course in Miracles. Had the touchstones of Sri Anandamaya Ma. Had the touchstone of Ramana Maharshi and others. And I knew what's authentic. So when the inauthentic comes and says, bow to me, I'm it. I said, you know, well, you're very glamorous and attractive, but you're not it. However, it's very intimidating. Egotists, very high egotists, are very intimidating, because they just say, hey, they double down on everything. They say, I'm it. If you don't get it, then you're a failure. And they put a spiritual guilt trip on you, very severe. I've had that happen to me. By several teachers, spiritual egotists who have literally laid an enormous authority entitlement trip on me, and severe guilt trip. The worst guilt trip I ever had laid on me was by a spiritual egotist who's, you know, who was acting as a teacher. No spiritual teacher lays a guilt trip on you. They don't lay an entitlement trip on you. Okay, they don't say, I am the one. I am the only one. This is it. Here I am. That's nonsense. It's ridiculous. Nandamaya Ma never said that. She said, I didn't come here for any karma. I'm perfectly awake to my own identity within God as one with God. But she didn't say I'm the only one or whatever. None of that. Didn't even like to talk about herself at all. Mother of Heart, she never said anything like that. Of Course in Miracles says there's many teachers. Many. The one who comes and says, I am it. There's no other. I am the Supreme. Bow to me. That's a spiritual egotist. And then the one that says that if you don't stick with them, that you're choosing separation, that you're choosing to forget what you are and all this kind of stuff, that's a spiritual guilt trip. That's nonsense. That's spiritual egotism as well. There are many teachers. There are many satsangs. The remembrance of what we are is within us. What we are is within us at all times. It can reach through and remind us in many ways. The one way about it is that ultimately we have to have the vision of oneness. We have to abide in the vision of oneness, the experience of that perfect, pure non-modification. That is truly the one way that we all must go through. That is the narrow gate that Jesus spoke about. We all must go through that. But there are many attracting us to that, many clarifying that, very many, always has been, always will be. But there were some extreme spiritual egotists. I don't want to get into naming them, etc., but they caused a great problem here. They slowed a lot of people down. They frightened a lot of people. They intimidated a lot of spiritual aspirants. They slowed us down. But we need to now pick it up, pick up the pace. Most of them aren't here anymore. They did their damage, but they didn't succeed. They failed. Because the bridges are here. The retreats will be here. The satsang will take place. Many will be helped. We just need to, heal our wounds, so to speak. Because the entitlement trip and the guilt trip, the spiritual guilt trip that was put on this planet was terrible. I'll tell you that right now. I was nearly crushed by it. Because when you have someone saying, this is it, I am the way, you must follow my teachings, you must do what I tell you to do, and if you don't, you're missing the boat, you're blowing at your opportunity. Powerful thing, it's frightening. You get a sense of wanting to say, no, this is not it, but the same hand, you're afraid, because these teachers who have an entitlement complex, they feel entitled to crush you. Literally. And their devotees also feel entitled to crush you if you speak up against it, criticize them in any way. You're putting yourself in harm's way. Because for them, entitlement complex, the egotism, the end justifies the means. Their ego trip justifies doing anything. And so a lot of us, we're cowering in fear, We don't dare say, hey, you're not it. Don't dare do that. It's frightening. Or we don't dare say, this isn't it. There are other ways. Hey, let's broaden things out. But some did. But this powerful type of satsang of clarification, which I'm part of right now, that was very difficult to do. I couldn't do it. Because I didn't want to appear to be opposing some of the authorities of these spiritual egotists. People would say, hey, who are you? Why, what are you saying this? What are you doing? What do you think? Who do you think you are? That kind of thing. There's still some that say that. Who do you think you are? And I say, I'm just a humble spiritual aspirant who has worked very hard at self-inquiry and being, sharing and being of some value and service to the world. That's it. Well, they would say, wow, if you really had any spirituality, you would be with this teacher because they're it. It's that kind of intimidation. So they say, why don't you just shut up? Because, you're an egotist. That's what they would say. They'd try to twist it around, and that those who are not going with the spiritual egotist, they're the real egotist. That kind of trip, that kind of twisting things, and then the guilt trip of, well, if you go see them, if you leave them, you're a terrible person. know, if you leave the teacher, you're a terrible person, which is absolute nonsense, because you may have other sources that may be your cup of tea. Far better, far better. At least more suitable for you. So everyone has the right to leave whatever teacher they go to without any guilt whatsoever. And of course, the teacher is within their purview to say, you know, that maybe staying might be a good thing too. You know, it might be running away from the satsang. That's possible. But you should never have it feel a guilt trip. Because there are a lot of little tributaries that lead to greater and greater satsang. I try not to be critical, you know, of any of those. Some of them I feel are better than others, but, you know, they are what they are. If some people like them, maybe it'll be helpful for them. I feel most of the teaching is substandard on this planet because the planet has been under assault. And those people who gave substandard teachings, superficial teachings, weren't really bothered by the intimidation because they weren't really under assault so much. They were actually supported. Like, yeah, this is great. Oh yeah, there's another teacher I can mention, Eckhart Tolle, who seems to be doing a good job. He's very popular right now. But he certainly seems to be giving satsang and pointing towards the eternal now. So there's another example of someone who's working publicly. And he's really, you know, almost mainstream. He's kind of the one that a lot of the academic spiritualists like. He seems to have sort of a fit into the university, the model of the well-educated people. I think he went to, I don't know, Cambridge or Oxford or something. So people of that status like to have a teacher that kind of looks like a profound professor or keeps the situation in the mode that they're comfortable with. And there are others like Muji who appeal to the spiritual pilgrim. You know, he doesn't give off an era of a university professor at all, you know. He gives off the sage, the guru, the pilgrim, the spiritual gypsy, the ones who have been seeking enlightenment in the nooks and crannies of India and faraway east and places, the Himalayas. And there are a lot of people who are on the path, the hippie trail, you know, went over to India from Europe and the United States, Western kind of United States too. And they went through all these really, you know, gurus and they went on a real trip. And Muji can appeal to those who feel very comfortable with that. You know, different appeal. Very different appeal. Eckhart Tolle and Uji have different people are drawn to them, really. And for me, I seem to draw the mavericks, because I'm a maverick. I seem to draw those who really are not really strongly affiliated with any situation, that somehow they just seem to have an intuition about it. They seem to resonate with the basics of just seeing the basics. Not so much into gurus or teachers, really. There's some people really into gurus and teachers. And they want to have a superstar, someone who's seen as popular. It's very important that their teacher is seen as popular. And for me, I have no popularity. So here, I believe people are more interested in what I have to say and the big picture, catching a glimpse of the big picture and how simple it is, really. I don't have the charisma, you know, of other teachers, really. I never really tried. I don't have it, so there you go. But this is a style too. This is a style too. just doing what's easy, what comes natural for me, what's easy, not trying to do anything that's difficult. I can't really tell jokes. For some reason, I'm not a comedian. Whenever I try to tell a joke, it bombs. It backfires on me. Terrible, really. Every time I try to give a little humor to something, it has the opposite effect. You know, people just look at me, take offense. They don't get the joke. I tell a joke, nobody gets it. It's weird. So I'm not a comedian. Muji's a fabulous comedian. Really, maybe the best I've ever come across. Absolutely genius. And he uses that comedy to put people at ease, which is a great thing. He uses it in the right way to turn people towards truth. And so he has that style. You know, he has the maternal style, almost like a mother style. People call it the heart, you know, the hugs, the embraces, the longing gazes, the comedy, all those things. People, you know, they love that. Some certain types just love that. They love the guru. You know, they love the guru who's bringing all that. And again, Eckhart Tolle plays very well to the educated crowd, the graduate crowd, the PhD crowd, the master's degree crowd, those who have a university degree, those who are steeped in academia, who are able to attend these seminars, who have the money to attend seminars and retreats, and are part of that, you know, therapist mode as well. And of Course in Miracles has a very different crowd. You know, I really don't know what to make of the Course community. I really don't. It's very elusive, really, as far as the what that crowd is really about. It's kind of the crowd of loving kindness, I guess you would say, of simply trying to love one another. And there's a lot of that, a lot of professions of love to one another. Pretty much fairly equalitarian, no real star teachers, really, just groups, simple groups around the globe, just studying the Course and mainly trying to impress upon one another how much they love one another as spirit. It's like that agape kind of thing. I don't feel a powerful clarification from the groups of the Course. They're more into, again, giving that reassurance to one another that they are truly loved. And I guess they feel this is what Jesus is emphasizing. Now, I don't quite get that out of the Course. I get something a little bit different in that clarification is the highest love. That's what I get. So I feel I'm giving, you know, what I believe is the highest love, which is clarification of the big picture and being adamant about it. Admonishment, you know, it's called tough love, I guess you'd call it. I'm not about the embraces and the hugs and saying I love you and all this stuff. I'm more about tough love, saying you've got to clarify to the point where you choose a new idea. You have to get there. If you don't get there, you're going to come up short. Come up short, you're going to be attracted back to some aspect of existence. Maybe even some egotistical guru you'll be attracted to. You'll be attracted to some facet of existence that will pull you back into it, and you forget once again. So you've got to really work on clarification intensely. That's what I got when I was studying the Course in Miracles. I got a lot of time with Jesus, a lot of time during sleep. Many times I met with him, and then a lot of time with the Holy Spirit. But the times of meeting with Jesus, he always emphasized, go faster, more intense. He said, forget about the Course community. Forget about the teachers that say they're teaching the Course. He said, don't pay any attention to any of that. Forget about it. Go faster. Speed it up. Work on clarification. Simplify it. You know, it's very intense. He didn't come across to me as some, hugger at all. Now, he'd just say, hey, he would say basically, look, there's a lot of trouble coming up in the world. Very bad situations coming up. You have to make the grade. You have to go all out. Get going. You can do it. Don't be lazy. It's kind of that kind of thing. The Holy Spirit, first thing the Holy Spirit said, impressed upon me, he said, you have choices. You either can go for it or you can be lazy. And if you don't go for it and you don't succeed, then you're lazy. And that hit a nerve with me big time, because if there's one thing I don't like being called as lazy, you know, that really got my goat. Because the one thing I'm not is I'm not lazy. And that's the ultimate insult, you know. You do not want to be lazy. Because laziness, of course, is the worst sin of all, really. And because it breeds failure. So the Holy Spirit laid it out for me. It showed me the course. Says, you know, you want to do this? Can you do it? I said, I don't know. The Holy Spirit says, what do you mean you don't know? Do you mean you can't do it, or you're too lazy to do it? And when I heard that, I said, holy cow, that got me. Got really upset. I said, wow, Holy Spirit's right. I definitely can do it. And the only reason I wouldn't do it is if I chose to be lazy. That's it. And so in putting it that way, I had no choice. Had to do it. Had to ace the course. Had to go for it totally. And then Jesus told me to say, you gotta work harder. That's basically all I got out of Jesus. If you go to Jesus, what are you going to get? He's going to tell you, you got to work harder. That's it. Same thing with Anna my Ma. What did she say? Work harder. You can do better. Don't come to me for a pat on the back. Well, they say, yeah, you're working good. That's great, but you got to work harder. You're a little bit lazy. Come on, what are you doing? Go faster. Put more time into it. Put more effort into it. Jesus says in the Course, you know, you need to remind yourself 1,000 times a day of the truth in order to erode the doubt. We have a little doubt left in us still. 1,000 times a day, he says. 1,000 times a day, you know. It's that kind of thing. These great teachers are taskmasters. They're not, you know, huggy teachers in my experience. They're not reassuring you like, yeah, you're great. Isn't it wonderful? Which, nothing wrong with that. That's very helpful. But my experience with these uber gurus, you know, these super gurus, is that, boy, they crack the whip. They practice tough love. They say, you want to succeed, you got to give it your all, period. Ma was notorious. The closer you were to her, the more she'd put on your shoulders of work. That's why the people around her looked so miserable. You didn't have a bunch of blissed out devotees around her at all. If you look at her devotees, they're very serious. They're sad and they're serious, and they're like they got the weight of the world on their shoulders. It's like, wow. You know, not a bunch of smiling, blissed out devotees around her at all. No way. Why? Because she'd say, hey, get up at 4 in the morning. You know, I want at least 10 hours of satsang out of you today. And once you get used to that, I want 14 hours out of you. And then I want continuous out of you. And I want you to be more and more austere with your habits, and just drove them, you know, like a taskmaster with a driving, whipping them to give more, give more, give more. Brutal. Very, very tough. And that's my experience. That's my experience, you know. Very tough love. Very uncompromising. You come to them, you expect to, you know, to say, wow, you're really great. And they'll say, hey, you're pretty lazy, aren't you? That's what they'll say. You're really lazy. You know, you're really thinking about failure, aren't you? And, you know, they're honest. They're telling you the truth. You're not very good. You need to put in a lot more effort. You need to cut down on your wasting time. You need to use every moment as an expedient to do better. That's what you get. That's literally what you get. Now, Muji can be tough, too. I can see that. You know, he's very serious, too. But he's also very charming and very reassuring. Because it seems to me a lot of those who come to see them are trying to get their feet wet. they're moving in the direction. They're thinking, wait a minute, this world, things aren't looking very good. Maybe I better get my feet wet here. You know, because let's face it, the YouTube culture is not exactly highbrow. And a lot of them see Bougie on YouTube and they say, hey, this is really entertaining. I like this, you know. Let me get my feet wet. So, of course, he's very loving to them, very loving. But I get the feeling that he can, again, be very tough on those who are closer to him, saying, hey, you need to do more. I can see that he has that side of very serious toughness if he wants to. But he's able to overlay that with sort of a seeming maternal softness, kind of like, no problem, no problem. Come, give me a hug, you know. Don't worry about it. Like that. That's a style. That's a style. But these uber gurus, I've not experienced that with them myself, no. They look at you, you know. They look right through you. They don't care what you say. They'll tell you, hurry up, go faster. That's it. You know, no long discussions. No long discussions about reality and blah, blah, blah. You know, I never had those discussions with Jesus or Nanda Maima. I had one meeting with Ramana Maharshi. Never had any discussions at all. Basically, they just said, you know, work harder. Go for it. You can do it. Well, of course, they're saying you can do it. We know you can do it, but you got to do it. Go for it. And Ramana, case Ramana, he was reassuring. He said, "Hey, what you're doing, I really like it. It's very helpful, very valuable. Will it turn out to be very valuable? So stick with it." That's what he said. Didn't have any discussions about truth. Why do they need to do that? They know what the goal is. They know that we are aiming towards that. So what they really say is work harder, because only hard work will pay off. The work ethic is all important. You're never going to get there if you don't work at it, if you don't put in your hours in self-inquiry. I used to be a musician, you know, and I'd put in 10 to 14 hours of practice every day. 8 hours was nothing, you know. That's nothing. A day of practicing 8 hours a day, that was probably not enough. You know, I probably should put in 10, or maybe 14. Maybe you have some jam sessions, you're playing some live music, and you know, you're playing that for maybe 4 hours, but then you go back and you need to practice 4 hours more, etc. Every day I'd put in enormous amount of time like that. So for me, putting an enormous amount of time on something was just normal, as it is for most people. Most people put an enormous amount of time on their career, their job. So it's just like that. You just have to put in that enormous amount of time on self-inquiry and put that effort in. And of course, one has to believe it's worthwhile. Some Bougie will still tell people, yeah, sure, it's worthwhile. You know, and kind of look at them like, yeah, you know, of course it is. And smile and keep it light. Keep it light, because those people are wondering, you know, should I really put in so much time doing that, or should I go with the smartphone crowd and try to, you know, log everything and everybody, what's going on, and feel like I'm part of something really profound, because I know where everyone's location is. I know that such and such is over to getting a latte, you know, somewhere. I know exactly where they are. I can tweet them, that kind of thing. And they're, you know, attracted to that entitlement. Really, the smartphone crowd is attracted to entitlement, because that's what's being sold. All this technology is selling a spiritual ego trip of entitlement. It's very attractive. Very attractive to many. And so they go to Muji and they're wondering, hey, you know, I don't want to leave my smartphone for too long, you know. In fact, I even want to have it with me. I think even Muji even lets people have their phones. It seems like sometimes I hear phones going off, people talking on their phones, you know, sending messages, receiving messages. At least it used to be that way. I don't know how it is now. Probably not into formal satsangs, but, you know, very tolerant of that, because people are evaluating, like, do I really want to go on the spiritual path and really dedicate myself to that? You know, can I at least maybe do it, you know, for 10 minutes a day and that's enough? Or can I go see Muji once and that's enough? I get the hit, I get the diksha, the darshan, the shakti pot, whatever. You know, he doesn't do that, but I get the hug, I get the hit, you know, of the guru, I get the feel, the high, and they think that should be enough, that should get me through the rest of my life, that should motivate me to be entitled. You know, most people, let's be honest, they're searching for entitlement, right? Almost everyone. I was that way, everyone's that way, to some extent. We're searching for entitlement. That's why we look at these some gurus who are spiritual egotists, and they're attracted to say, wow, this one will really show me how to get this sense of entitlement. I might even be their, you know, a devotee of theirs, a high devotee, and I'll really feel entitled. So I can say, hey, you know, I'm the top devotee of God, you know? You know, that's very sense of a great entitlement there. So, you know, they're wondering, and, you know, Muji treats them with great grace. Really, that's a great thing. I'm not able to do that. I would say, you know, hey, you gotta get to work, you know, no two ways about it. Don't waste your time with this stuff. But that's a more abrupt, direct approach. I just, you know, don't have the soft touch. Not everyone does. That's a gift. And really, that gift with the younger generation, smartphone generation, YouTube generation, it's very helpful. The demographics of these videos, the satsang, is very much from the people 45 to 65. Older crowd. Because the younger crowd, they require, because they're really tempted, very strongly tempted, to go along with this ego trip that's on this planet now, with all the stuff, the accoutrement of ego tripping, all the gadgets. You know, which is basically be able to tell where anyone is at any time. You can kind of stalk anybody at any time, so to speak. Know what they're doing, know their life. You can tap into all that. You can get the data. There are ways to do that. You can be a real snoop. You can be a real control freak. You can do all these things with a smartphone and all the apps, etc. You can really pin people down, intimidate them, etc. Bully them. So it's very, very attractive to our spiritual egotism. Go on an ego trip so we can continue to pretend to be prime creators. Very attractive. And so someone like Muji gives them a soft touch. He says, hey, don't worry about it. It's all good. And they kind of laugh, you know, they laugh, and he laughs, and everybody laughs, and they smile, and they smile, and everyone smiles, and then he says, but, you know, who's doing it? You know, and then sort of kind of says, hey, but, you know, but... And then, so they kind of like that style, like, you know, they feel like, well, maybe we can have both. Maybe we can have both. And then they, you know, so they kind of, Muji kind of says, well, you know, hey, what do you think? I don't know. And leaves the door open, doesn't really push hard, you know, maybe they think maybe we can have both. Maybe we can do both. And that's a stage. That's a stage. And gradually they start thinking, hey, well, maybe what Muji has is better. You know, maybe it's better than this. I don't know. They start thinking about it. It's like that. Whereas I tend to draw in those who are older, you know, 44 to 65 and over. Not many who are over 65 are actually on the internet, on YouTube, to tell you the truth. It's kind of a dividing line. If you're over 65, you may not be paying attention here. But for some reason, those are like 45 to 65. Very strong group right there. And it's about three quarters male, one quarter female, 75-25% is the demographics here, which is what you'd expect also. Because females are generally more comfortable with multitasking. They're more comfortable with the feeling they need to do it all. And they need an approach which is not too strong. Doesn't come on saying like, "Hey, you got to drop this, and you really have to commit to this." They're not really comfortable with that. You know, at least 75% of them, and some are more comfortable with focusing in on just one one thing, say, I got to commit to this. It's very important. Because obviously females have to multitask with children, with in-laws, with the whole social gamut of raising children. Multitasking is very important. You have to try to be all things to everyone. So, but on the spiritual path, you know, you really have to commit to clarity and go for it. So there is a period of time where that seems to be too drastic. So females are generally drawn towards those who have a softer touch, like Muji. I think Muji's satsang is maybe 75% female and 25% male, like the reverse, because he has that wonderful reassuring soft touch that is saying, hey, you don't have to give up your multitasking. You don't have to give that up, you know, don't worry about it. And that's very reassuring. Whereas the male, they're used to committing to a career, see, used to committing and excelling in something, maybe in one thing, being really good at one thing. And so what I say is, yeah, that's great. Be really good at satsang, be really good at self-inquiry, just go for it. Excel at it. Drop everything else. That's my direct, you know, my advice. Just commit. When I came across the Course in Miracles, I committed to it. I dropped everything else. Totally committed to it. I said, this is it. I'm going for it. All out. I'm going to excel at this. Period. So instead of practicing guitar, you know, for 14 hours a day, I studied the Course for 14, 18 hours a day. Literally. Sometimes 20 hours a day. Hardly slept at all sometimes because I couldn't sleep. For some reason, it was terrible. But, you know, I could read the Course, study the Course, try to follow along, you know, with this. It was like, so those who are really accustomed through tradition to excel at something, at one thing. Now, of course, the females have careers now too, but they're also multitasking still. Because also family is very important too. But males traditionally, you know, have just said, you know what, I gotta excel at something totally. And I'll just commit my entire life to that. And historically in my other incarnations, I was that way. Way, all in, total commitment to excel at something. Wasn't multitasking, really. I just ignored everything else. And a lot of men are that way. So they resonate to this more direct approach to saying, hey, there's something you need to excel at. It's called satsang. It's called self-inquiry. And you have to give it your all. Forget about everything else. You don't have to excel at anything else. All you have to do is remember what you are. Choose a new idea. That's it. And so, like I said, that's the demographics here. That's the approach, and it's not an approach for everybody. Just as Muji's approach is not an approach for everybody either. A lot of the teachers in this time now are have a soft touch. This more very decisive, intense, tough love approach here, big picture approach, you know, get the big picture, forget about everything else. Is not so much in vogue during these times, because a lot of females are very much into spirituality and the path, and that's not the approach that they favor. So a lot of teachers now have this soft approach, kind of don't worry, you know, just, you know, you can do it, you can do it all kind of thing, don't worry about it, and then gradually try and, you know, lead them into greater commitment, which they're very capable of doing. They're very capable of committing, but they really have to do it their way. They have to have sort of multitask into the commitment, as it were. They have to have the accoutrement all around. They have to have a lot of feeling of a family. You know, the sangha has to feel like a family. And they have to. They tend to look up to the teacher, you know, as some revered family figure. Something that feels like there's this emotional heart feeling about the whole situation that has to come first, and then gradually they work into really serious, intense focus And some have succeeded too. There are female teachers who have succeeded on this planet. No question about it. Who are now teaching, giving satsang, and having a good soft touch, which helps females out a lot. But it's not so helpful for a lot of males, actually. Males are lagging behind now. What I've seen is a lot of males feel lost because they really want to commit and go all in and go for it. And there's really not so many teachers like that around. Really is not. A lot of males really liked Ananda Maya Ma because she was so tough. She'd just tell them, hey, you want to be my devotee? You want to listen to what I have to say? Meditate constantly and don't stop. You know, that's what she'd tell them. And they loved it. And that's what they wanted to hear. So most of those who she contacted were males, actually. Her sangha, her support group, were mostly female. That was because that was tradition. But actually, she was constantly contacting male devotees and meditators and spiritual aspirants, and you know, whipping them into shape, saying, you know, you're doing good work, but you're coming up short, and you can't afford to come up short, so you better get even more devoted to your work and, you know, be much tougher. And that's what they love that. You know, that's what many men want to hear that. You know, make it your sole focus. That's it. Drop everything else. I mean, she'd literally tell them, forget about your family, forget about your wife, forget about your job. Become a renunciate right now and go for it. That's what she'd tell them. And of course, the wives didn't like her. And she didn't care. Really, it's amazing. She was very tough on the females and wives, basically saying, hey, this is what men need to do, and you can't stay in this, can't stand in their way. It's very important. It will have great helpfulness to you eventually too. But you know, she broke up families, broke up marriages, I mean, in a nice way, in a good way. But she'd say, hey, you know, you have to go for it. If you want my help, you have to go for it. And you got a right to make that choice. Because in India, that was tolerated, you know. It was, especially when men reach a certain age of retirement age, they have every right to be a renunciate and leave the family. And she totally supported that. Drop everything. Drop everything. No alimony, you know, so to speak. But right now, you know, men can't do that. They're expected to provide support, and so they're kind of having to do it all. And it's very difficult for men, really very difficult, because their tendency is to have exclusive focus, extreme, pinpoint, strong, committed focus to one path that provides excellent, they excel at. And it's very tough to multitask. It's not their way, really. So a lot of satsangs are heavily, the demographics are heavily female. Some like 90%, really. And the men are just like shrinking violets. I've seen it. They're just shrinking violets, you know. It's not great for them, really. In a lot of ways. You cannot be a shrinking violet like that. That's not good for men, really. Men have to be intense. They have to go for it. And excel. But they have to have wise intensity, which is all important. Not egoic intensity. Wise, intuitive intensity that is humble, that realizes they're up against it, that realizes success will not come easy, that realizes that they're still attracted to spiritual egotism. It's a wisdom, but it's an intensity with a humility, which is how men excel through that humility and intensity and tremendous focus. And a lot of females excel at feeling their way into it as a family type of thing, as a heart type of thing, and just having tremendous feel for it. That's generally the way a lot of women succeed, a lot of females succeed, is tremendous feel for the situation. And they have this enormous capacity to feel their way into it like that, while on the surface continuing to seem to multitask, even though their feeling has been withdrawn from that. They're still functioning in a social, normal social way, but their feel is completely on this towards the vision of oneness. But they may seem to be still very sociable, you know, just in normal mode, whereas men, when they get very intensely focused, they can seem to be very disinterested in socializing, really. I never had any interest in socializing at all. None. I could care less about socializing at all. Never socialized. Had no interest in it. Only interested in excelling at self-inquiry. That's it. You know, put me in a monastic cell, you know, for 10 years, I'd probably be happy. Pretty happy with that at a certain time. But, so many teachers, many satsangs, many styles. Some emphasize the feel your way into it. Others emphasize the clarify your way into it using reason. And like I said, those styles lead, our little streams leading into bigger streams, leading into little rivers, into bigger rivers. Eventually one can get into more and more profound satsang where the genders kind of, the approach is pretty much the same. It's very serious, very profound. No nonsense. Intense effort. Very strict. You know, some of those very loving gurus like Ananda Mayama, everyone thought she was so loving, but she was really the strictest of the strict. Incredibly strict. Ridiculously strict by some evaluations, you know. Just off the charts strict. I mean, every little detail she could say, you know, you gotta do it this way and that way, and just very severe. People were just, you know, shocked by her severity. Strictness. For those who could handle it. And so some of her female devotees, you know, they were miserable in a lot of ways because, you know, they had to be so strict with themselves, really. Eventually she demanded their renunciations as well. Pushed them very hard. Tough for them, very tough. But very effective. That was a heavyweight situation. So, eventually, you know, the satsang becomes more profound. You know, the flowers can still be there, for sure. Beauty can still be there. Serenity, everything can still be there. But it's no nonsense, very strict. And that comes about gradually. It comes about gradually as one gets more and more serious and one sees that the goal is reachable. When one sees the goal is reachable, then one will accept strictness and admonishments and being pushed. They'll accept it. They say, oh, great, thank you. That's great. I want that push. They don't take offense at it. Not offended. Those who are lazy, not sure, they'll get very offended if you push them. Because they don't really see if it's possible to succeed. They don't know. I say, maybe, I don't know, but why are you pushing me into something that I don't even know if I can succeed at it or not? Or if it's really possible for anyone to succeed, they're not sure. But once one becomes sure it's possible, then, you know, hey, not a problem. Criticism, you know, admonishment is accepted and even welcomed, you know. And Jesus, of course, in Miracles, points out all the mistakes we're making. Say, hey, you're making this mistake. Every time I see it, I say, great, wonderful, glad to see it. Because I knew the goal was reachable. And I know I can reach it. So, of course, seeing mistakes is like wonderful. It's the greatest thing ever. Say, aha, you know, there's another deception that I've been tricked by, another way I've been misled. Nothing's better than to uncover that, you know, and say, wow, now I see how I was deceived in a certain way. Isn't that great? Now I see I've been lazy. Isn't that great? So, we're looking forward to more and more profound satsangs. You know, hey, even the music gets better, right? Really. Muji has some good music in his satsangs, but it can get even better than that. Believe me. The music can become very, very amazing as far as being used in satsang. Simple, very simple, very powerful, very profound, very attention grabbing, you know. Not that it's an end in itself, but the whole accoutrement of the satsang can become more profound than what we're seeing on the planet right now. Definitely. And it will feel normal to us once we have acclimatized that. We'll just say, yeah, I mean, this, we're ready for it. We're ready for it. Muji's doing a great job, as are others, to help us move forward with satsang so that it even becomes even more profound for us. And eventually we actually succeed in taking that step, that necessary step, that all-important step. We actually do it. And they're positive that we will do it. And so we have that ahead of us. It's wonderful. It's great. We're not second-class citizens, you know, really. Those who attend satsang are not second-class citizens. They're first-class citizens. They don't take a back seat to anyone. And what they have ahead of them is very profound, very beautiful, very wonderful, very effective, and will eventually result in remembrance of what they really are, what we really are, which is spirit, remembrance of reality, remembrance of the Prime Creator, and then remembrance of how to function the way we were created to function, and then ultimately functioning in that way. We're seemingly a long ways off from that, to tell you the truth. But the fact is, once we have a perfect reflection, a perfect remembrance of what we are, which is very simple, choose a new idea, the idea of not trying to be Prime Creator, we get that effect automatically, right then and there, that instant, and we can abide in that, and that will give us a perfect remembrance of what we are. And once we get that, once we abide in that imperfect remembrance of what we are, and get very accustomed to abiding in that, so it's effortless abidance, that we feel completely comfortable, no desire to, we become like Ramana was, like that, once we like that, piece of cake to then function fully, the way that we are created to function, piece of cake, no problem whatsoever. But from where we're at right now, it seems like we're a long ways off, because we think that there's some kind of process we have to go through, you know, other than simply abiding in that, the perfect stillness that is present right now, that non-modifiable effect, which comes about from just a simple choice. We don't realize that, how simple it is. So we believe it's a long ways off for us, but it's really not. Like for me, I don't know how far it's off. Maybe it could be, you know, a year off. As far as making choosing that, it could be a day off, a year off, 10 years, I don't know. And then once one of chooses a new idea and abides in that, how long does one abide in it? I don't know. Probably at that point it doesn't really matter, because one's enjoying abiding in it so much. Could be a day, could be a lifetime, could be, you know, a decade, I don't know. But at that point it doesn't matter. But really, choosing a new idea could be very close for all of us. For me, I believe it's very close, but who knows, it might be years down the road, I don't know. But I know that, I mean, that is close, right? Years down the road is very close. And I know it's very simple, extremely simple, simply one simple choice. Easy, simple, obvious choice is all that it takes. And then from that point on, done. Done deal. One just naturally abides in the effect of that new idea. That's it. Done deal. It's over. Deal is done. So, it's not that far off for us. It really isn't. We don't have some long road to travel at all. Once you get into satsang, you don't have a long road to travel. You have to work at it, of course. A lot, there will be effort there, but you don't have a long road to travel. The road is short. Guaranteed, it's short. And very wonderful. We've bridged the times. We're here now. We're moving. We're into June 2012. We're very close now. So everybody, get ready. It's go time. It's really go time. And it's probably time for me to go to bed. So, very great. And that's it.